Na die Tweede Wereldoorlog, toe die Engelse theaterveld in Suid-Afrika braak gelê, het nog 'n belangrike theaterpersoonlikheid, Brian Brooke, na Suid-Afrika gekom en oor 'n lang tydperk 'n groot bydrae gelewer tot ons theaterontwikkeling. Brian Brooke Thompson, netjies uitgevat in sy skooldrag. Dit was natuurlik jare gelede, toe die familie nog op hulle plaas Brooklands in die Oost-Transvaalse Laagveld gewoon het. Brian was 'n aantreklike kerel. Iets wat hom goed te pas gekom het toe hy Suid-Afrika as jong man in die vroeë 30er jare verlaat het om in Engeland te gaan toneel speel. Hy het dikwels die rol van die aantreklike jong kerel vertolk in die Engelse repertoriumgeselskappe. Daar het hy die jong aktrise Petrina Fry ontmoet, met wie hy later getroud is. Haar ouers was albei aan die theater verbonde. Reginald Fry en die regisseuse Mary Byron. Hy sluit by die Britse leer aan toe die Tweede Wêreldoorlog uitbreek. In 1946 vestig die Brooke familie hulle in Suid-Afrika. Hy stig 'n Engelse beroepsgroep, die Brian Brooke Geselskap, en huur die Hofmeyr Theater, waar hy 10 jaar lank gereeld opgevoer het. Sy vrou Petrina was sy hoofspeelster en steunpilaar. Daarna volg 'n lang uitmergelende stryd om 'n permanente beroepstoneel daar te stel en om finansiëel staande te bly. Brian Brooke het aan die begin menigvuldige probleme gehad. Daar was min Engelse professionele akteurs en ook 'n gebrek aan opgeleide tegnici en ontwerpers. Hy het baie hard gewerk, gespeel, regie gedoen, publisiteit, die administratiewe werk en selfs stelle ontwerp en gebou. Dit het deursettingsvermoe gekos. Maar met sy optimisme triomfeer hy, nie net in Kaapstad nie, maar ook in Johannesburg.
Well, you know, we'd been at the Hofmeyr Theatre for 10 years, and when we came up here on a tour, we were at the Alexander Theatre, and we were the most resounding flop. And I realized that I simply had to have a home of our own, where we could establish our own identity in what was obviously going to be the mecca of theatre in South Africa, and that is Johannesburg. Well, I looked around, and one night I found that the Apostolic Faith Mission was up for sale in De Villiers Street, and I thought, this is it, we're going to turn this church into a theatre. And indeed, it worked very well. Of course, we had tremendous difficulty in finding the finance because I only had just a fraction of the money I had. But fortunately at the time, Emlyn Williams came out, and this gave me some sort of prestige, and we managed to raise in the end the money we needed. And so we decided to open with a play called The Deep Blue Sea. Now, just prior to that, I'd been to London. And before the opening, at the Malvern Theatre, we discovered in the prop room there two beautiful candelabra standards. And when I found out that these had come from Blenheim Palace and were absolutely priceless, I said, what a wonderful thing it would be to have the Brooke Theatre. And the next morning, our host said, we're going to donate these to the Brooke Theatre, and I hope they'll be in South Africa for all time, because they're absolutely priceless. And so, anyhow, the first night arrived, and the Deep Blue Sea curtain went up, and I was wondering whether the acoustics would be all right. And then suddenly Petrina was on the stage, and the curtain went up. I played a small part, but I didn't come on for quite a long time. And I sat up in the circle, and I was there, and I was waiting for the acoustics, and I heard Petrina pick up a shoe brush and start to polish Freddie's shoes. And I could hear this shoe brush from right at the back of the circle. And I thought, oh, what a relief we've made. Well, ultimately, of course, the Brooke Theatre became, I suppose, after many successes with straight plays, the sort of musical house. It's not a big musical house, but it did harbour many, many successes. We started off as Salad Days, and then The Boyfriend, which was a huge success and actually paid for most of the bond we had raised. And then we did The Sound of Music, and then I discovered this lovely little star called Heather Lloyd-Jones, and I put her in to a thing called Irma La Douce, which really, I suppose, must be registered as the greatest success that the theatre's ever known. It's not the longest run, because the longest run, of course, was the Black Theatre, which we started here, and that was a show called Epitombe, which is still running all over the world.
En zo het hij gekomen om te blijven. Hij was een van ons landse bekendste theaterpersoonlijkheden. Brian Brook, acteur-bestuurder en een van die baanbrekers van die commerciële theater in Zuid-Afrika, heeft in 1980 op 69-jarige ouderdom uitgetree. Die Brook Theater bestaan niet meer. Bekende Zuid-Afrikaanse acteurs en oorzeese sterren het daar opgetree. Pyjama Tops was die laatste opvoering. Meer dan 5 miljoen theatergangers het in die 23 jaar van die theaterse bestaan opvoerings daarbij gewoon. Een mens kan Brian Brook die vader van die commerciële theater in Zuid-Afrika noemen.
I knew what I wanted. You know, I was a talented little girl with curls and all the little gold medals and all the prizes. I knew early on I wanted to be married and I wanted to have a family. I suppose that the house and the home is, I suppose the word one wants to use, the anchor of one's life. It's where I can have my grandchildren, it's where my children come and see me. It's where visually I have my happiest moments of my life. You see, colour always meant something to me. I always loved looking at colour. I used colour a great deal in the theatre and in clothes. I think taste really is your colour more than anything else. People wonder what you can do. I'm quite, as you see, I'm quite brave about colour. I don't mind using it boldly if I want to. It's your personality. And then, of course, here in this darling little home of mine, which I love, I really am in love with my home, I look out the window and see the flowers and the different colours. That's what strikes me first.
Taubi Kuschlik heeft geen bekendstelling nodig nie. Allemaal ken of weet van haar. Zij is een groot naam in Zuid-Afrika, een persoonlijkheid, sterk en overweldigend als mens en theatermens. Zij is speelster, regisseuse, impresario, vrouw, moeder en oma. Zuid-Afrikaanse theatergeschiedenis zou armer geweest zijn zonder Taubi Kuschlik. Zij is geboren op Loekhof in die Vrijstaat, een van 6 kinders. Maar zij groeit op in Port Elizabeth. Na school is zij Londen toe, waar zij een degelijke theateropleiding gehad het. Terug in Zuid-Afrika heeft zij haar eerste toneelstuk in 1931 in Port Elizabeth opgevoerd. Zij is ook jarenlang gelukkig getrouwd met haar Kushi, zoals zij liefdevol naar hem verwijst. Haar familie is voor haar die belangrijkste in haar leven. Zij is een bijzondere mens, vol van levensvreugde, dynamisch, flamboyant, maar dit is alles deel van haar persoonlijkheid.
I'm mad about people. They're not all mad about me, but I love people. What else have you got in the world but people?
Van jaar 1983 is hij reeds 53 jaar lang gemoeid met die theater. Een leeftijd. Allemaal wat al samen daar gewerkt het, staan verstomd over haar ongelooflijke werkvermoeien. Maar hulle vertel ook van haar warmte, haar menselijkheid en deernis. Van haar is al gezegd, she has divine and beautiful madness. Haar naam is synoniem met die Zuid-Afrikaanse theater. Taubi in haar eerste rol, Oberon, en Midsummer Night's Dream. Taubi heeft aan het begin van haar loopbaan dikwijls gespeeld. Een groot verscheidenheid rollen. Maar later heeft zij haar meer op regie toegeleid. Ik is een moeilijke mens om voor te werken, want ik gloe aan discipline in die theater. Die theater is niet in mijn bloed, niet. Het is een werk wat ik doe omdat ik daarvan hou. Taubi heeft die hoofdrol vertolkt in Little Foxes in die oude Standard Theater in Johannesburg. Dit was een baie succesvolle opvoering. In 1947 het sy gespeel in en die regie gedoen van die komedie George Washington Slept Here. Hierdie opvoering was ook in die Standard Theater. Taube het Lady Macbeth gespeel in 1942 in de Leontien saga in opvoering. In 1950 doen sy die regie en vertolk die rol van Jocasta in Oedipus Rex. André Huguenet het die hoofrol vertolk. Sy het opgevoer van Griekse tragedies tot muziekblijspelen, te veel om op te noemen. Van haar geliefkoosde muziekblijspelen was Listen to the Wind, Cabaret, Fiddler on the Roof, The Wizard of Oz, Porgy and Bess, A Little Night Music, No No Nanette en haar Jacques Brel aanbiedingen. Taube het met haar opvoerings baie kunstenaars aan die publiek bekendgesteld. Personen wat daarna succes in die theater behaal het. Sy het gesê, alles wat ik in mijn loopbaan bereik het, is ek aan Suid-Afrika verskuldig. Ek glo in die mense van Suid-Afrika. Hulle is my mense. Ek glo in my publiek en in my opvoerings. As impresario en regisseuse het sy haar suksesse en mislukkings gehad. In die Chelsea Theater in Hilbrand, klein en intiem, daar het Taube Kuschlik in 1974, Jacques Brel is Alive and Well and Living in Paris op die planken gebring. Daar het een buitengewone lang speel van gehad, die langste ooit. Sy voer het later ook oorsee op, met die oorspronkelijke Suid-Afrikaanse rolverdeling. Van Brel's lyrieke sê Taube, dit is poëzie op wieke van muziek. So het sy ook Cabaret aan ons mense bekendgestel. Die boodskap van die liefde, Leen Brel se liedjies opgesluit. Daar is iets vir allemaal in sy liedere. Elke mens kan hom met Brel identificeer.
Dan kraakt mijn land, mijn platteland. Dan lacht mijn land, mijn Vlaanderenland.
Well, here we are again. In 1972, exactly in this chair, I sat and we opened with Jacques Brel is Alive and Well and Living in Paris. And I got on that stage after great applause and shouting encore, encores. And I was asked how long I thought it was going to run, and I feebly and meekly said, well, maybe a year. Well, we've run, as you know, into 1980. And so, since that very first time, when everybody shouted that night, encore, encore, and I've read a great deal about Brel since, he never gave encores. He never believed in them. I suppose, because you know, Brel sang and wrote all his own songs. And he was very emotional. He got so involved with it all that he was completely finished when he got up from that piano, one of the reasons. And again, I think he was right. And now I've got 25 completely new songs, a bag of wonderful songs for all those people who saw our Jacques Brel thousands of times, who laughed and cried with us. I dedicate Encore Brel. It's a new, complete show. I've kept as closely as I can to translations. And now, I would like to tell you a little about the tenderness of Jacques Brel. That song Freddie sang had his irony, his bitter irony. But this man, Brel, as you all know, had the deepest compassion and tenderness for human beings. And I want to ask Anne now to sing the song of the old lovers.
In spite of all, we're still together. forget all those goodbyes, the crazy quest for bluer skies, the crazy chase from place to place, from hand to hand, from face to face. You don't forget the sleazy bars, the smell of wine and cheap cigars, the awful hangover you had as daylight dawned so gray and sad. No, there is no way to forget, no, nothing helps you to forget. Within your memories, you're bound as surely as the world is round. You don't forget the past, you don't forget at all. You don't forget, forget the past, you live with it. That's all.
From Toby with Love, 1981. Liedjies uit die musiekblij spelen wat sy deur die jare opgevoer het. Sy speel self ook daarin. Dit is 'n waardige huldeblyk aan haar. Die twee sangeresse is Judy Page en Marlo Scott Wilson. Haar swanesang. Pieter Toerien is al genoem, 'n merkwaardige bondel theaterenergie, wat hy inderdaad ook is. Die man agter die opvoerings, Suid-Afrika se grootste en bekwaamste impresario. Hy sit 'n ou tradisie voort. 'n Tradisie wat in die Victoriaanse era deur theaterpioniers soos die Wheelers, die Jongbroers, Bonamici en Leonard Rein begin is en later deur E.W. Schlesinger voortgesit is. Pieter Toerien was ook die eerste persoon om 'n theater te vernoem na die bekende akteur en theaterpionier André Huguenet. Iets wat lank voor 1977 al moes gebeur het. En het was ook hy wat die Alhambra Theater in Doornfontein, ons landse oudste bioscoop, gekoop en van sloping gered het, om so iets van ou Johannesburg vir die nageslag te bewaar.
Well, it's the commercial theatre that I feel most comfortable in. You see, when I was a schoolboy, instead of going to movies with friends, I went to the theatre. And very early in my life, I learned to sort of feel and love the sound of an audience reacting. So I grew up with going to plays. I went to plays at the Hofmeyr Theatre. I went to see variety shows and the big musicals at the Alhambra, the old Alhambra Theatre in Cape Town, which is sadly no longer with us. There were some fabulous shows brought out by African Consolidated Theatres. And it was actually at the Alhambra one night that I decided I was going to make the theatre my career. I'd been to see a show called, I think it was The Pajama Game, a big musical. And incidentally, that was the first show that brought Michael McGovern to South Africa. And I remember standing in the stalls of the theatre and looking about that beautiful, vast auditorium that was so filled with atmosphere. And it all sort of fell into place for me at that very moment. I suddenly thought, this is where I belong, and this is where I feel most at home. So right at that moment, I began to dream about putting shows onto the stage of that big theater. And a few years later, with the help of a lot of nice friends, and my dream came true. Well, from the long list of stars that we presented, obviously Dietrich must head the list. She's quite the most wonderful artist I ever worked with, and I'll always remember her with love and gratitude for all the advice and help she gave me. She taught me how important it is to be absolutely single-minded in this business. She taught me about self-discipline. Most of all, she taught me about perseverance. I don't think I could ever forget her. She had a profound effect on my life and on my career, and I will always remember her with gratitude. Then, of the 60 or 70 plays we've presented, I think the first one lingers in my memory because it marked a turning point in my career. We'd been presenting variety bills through the 60s, and suddenly came the 70s, variety was no longer popular, and I wanted to get into the legitimate theatre. So I thought, if you're going to do it, do it properly and do it big. So I went off to London and I got a whole handful of stars and scenery and costumes, and I put the whole thing together and brought it back to South Africa. It was a play called The Ideal Husband, and I put it on and I thought, well, there, if it works, that'll set me off for the 70s. If it doesn't, too bad. Happily, it was a great success. It was my first play, it was a big success, and it set the level for me for the 70s. Abelard and Eloise lingers in my mind because it put me together for the first time with Heather Lloyd-Jones. I'd had a crush on Heather from my school days, and when we started to produce plays, I offered her every play that came along. She turned them down with unfailing regularity, and then one day, much to my surprise, and I think even hers, she accepted the part of Eloise. It was incidentally the first play to have a nude scene in it in South Africa, so it became rather notorious. But it was Heather who made the play so special for me. Of course, one must mention Equus, which was probably the highlight of our play-producing period. It must rate as probably the most successful play in recent memory. And I must mention Murder Among Friends and Cardi Custard, which brought me together with the wonderful South African star Moira Lister. Moira is, alongside Dietrich, the most professional artist I've worked with. She's also probably the nicest.
Vandag, na alles wat Pieter Toerien al in die theaterwereld bereik het, is ons nie verbaas dat hy in 1965 as jong man 'n wêreldberoemde ster soos Marlene Dietrich aangedurf het nie. En dit was maar net die begin. Want sedertdien sorg hy vir die theaterpubliek van ons land. Deur sy toedoen word van die beste toneelstukke van oorsee hier op die planke gebring. Van 1969 tot vandag bring hy byna elke West End of Broadway stuk wat die moeite werd is na Suid-Afrika.
If everybody was as nice as Moira in this business, then life in the theatre would be a pleasure. But I must say, I have had the privilege of working with so many wonderful people. Of course, as in all fields, you have the good and the bad, though I wasn't really prepared for what I would call the worst. And she came to me in the form of Joan Fontaine. She made Michael McGovern look like a teddy bear, but she was the exception. The play in recent memory was our revival of Terence Rattigan's The Deep Blue Sea. I remember this one because it opened the André Huguenet Theatre and it consolidated my association with Shirley Firth. Shirley and I met, I think in 1973. I came back from overseas with a play called The Secretary Bird, and she was acting in a play that her own company was managing at the Intimate at the time that wasn't doing very well. So I rang her up and suggested that we do The Secretary Bird together. Well, the play was a great success, and the association worked beautifully. She handled the day-to-day running of the theatre, and that left me free to find new plays, read scripts, and do all our advanced planning, or plotting, as our team call it. So The Intimate led to The Bonato, and 3 years ago, finally, to the André Huguenet Theatre, which now houses productions by both Toerien and Firth plays and Pieter Toerien Productions.
Pieter Toerien is vandag 'n groot naam in die vermaaklikheidswêreld. Hy is bekend in theaterkringe in Londen en New York. Hy voer 'n warrelwind bestaan, altyd maar weer 'n nuwe toneelstuk en nog 'n openingsaand, en die onsekerheid wat daarmee gepaard gaan. Maar tog sê hy, daar's niks gelyk aan die theater nie. As 'n mens daar sit en wag vir die huislig om te doof, en dan die magiese oomblik as die gordyn opgaan. Hy sal met reg genoem Suid-Afrika se meneer theater. Vir 'n toneelstuk het hy 'n sesde sintuig, of dit 'n treffer gaan wees al dan nie. Hy ken die Suid-Afrikaanse gehoor en hy weet wat hulle wil hê. Sonder enige subsidie van die staat sorg hy vir vermaak. Sy aanbiedinge sluit in van melodramas, stoutklugte en rillers tot die heel beste toneelopvoerings, theater van die hoogste gehalte. Maine. Die Brickhill Burkes, Zuid-Afrika's bekendste theaterpaar, se jongste opvoering. Met natuurlijk Joan Brickhill als Auntie Maine. Vandaag is hulle huishoudelike name. En is vooral muziek blij spelen en kleurvolle glinsterende schouwspelen vol swier waarvoor hulle bekend is.
Handle with care. Show a little respect for age.
Age? What age? I have the feeling that time has altered like two straws on a chocolate malted. Is that how young I feel? I feel like Peckin' and Bonnie Hoggin and Lindy Hoffman and Jitterbuggin', cause that's how young I feel. I'm mad for that big band beat. Wanna ride in a rumble seat. Joan's got the Chevy lover face full of frozen custard to have a hot dog and sand and mustard and ride the Ferris wheel. Oh, honey, cause that's how young I feel.
Die gewilde muziekblijspel Oklahoma was de eerste opvoering wat Joan Brickhill en Louis Burke in Johannesburg aangebied het, met groot succes. Dit was in die vroege 60er jaren. In Durban het hulle toe reeds twee muziekblijspelen, Lady Be Good en The Boyfriend, aangebied. En daarna daar door die jaren ander opvoerings gevolg. The Sound of Music was een van hulle groot successe. Tino Louis Burke het die bekende Diane Todd opgetree. Judy Page was ook een van die sterre in The Sound of Music. They're Playing Our Song. Chris. Die rock'n'roll treffer uit die 50er jaren. Gypsy. I Love My Wife. En natuurlijk Annie. Allemaal muziek blijft spelen waardoor die Brickhill Burkes opgevoerd is. Joan Brickhill en Louis Burke was ook de eerste om die glinsterende follies en minstrelskouspelen in Zuid-Afrika op te voeren. Hulle het jaren geleden die Black and White Minstrel Show oor see gezien en toe besluit om het in Zuid-Afrika op die planken te brengen. Die Brickhill Burkes werken al meer dan 20 jaar samen. Het theater instellen. Baie acteurs, zangers, dansers en theatertechnici is al door hulle opgeleid. Die spel gaan voort, dus hulle enigste lezen.
the exciting nights I remember in our life was the opening night of the very first Minstrel Scandals at the old Alhambra Theatre in Cape Town. We had persuaded ACT to put on a big show. It was the first time it had ever happened, and I think in 1966 to spend something like 150,000 rand on a production was quite something. I remember Jim Stodel was very upset. The day the booking opened in Cape Town, we took 12 rand the first day the booking opened, and everybody was pacing up and down, getting more and more into a state of what's going to happen. Well, of course, by the time the opening night came, we had a lot of people coming to see the show on comps because the house wasn't full. Nobody knew anything about what Brick Hill Burke were up to, or certainly what a Minstrel Scandals was. But it was one of the most triumphant nights in the theatre that I've ever known, because we had not only a standing ovation, but by the end of the evening, we had everybody absolutely screaming and crying out for more. The next day, there was a leader article in the Cape Times saying, at last, South African theatre turns international. And the following morning, the queue at the box office went from the box office right around the theatre, right around the block, and continued. In fact, they took 25,000 rand in that one day of booking. All the people were fainting. They had nurses and hospitals and doctors and all sorts of things there to try and help with the crowds. But it was the beginning of what show business was really about, international show business was really about in this country, and it was quite exciting.
Joan Brickhill is al met recht genoemd South Africa's first lady of show business. Haar veelzijdigheid als verhoogkunstenaar is haar grootste baten. En dan natuurlijk ook haar ongelooflijke werkvermoe. Hello Dolly met Joan als die ster was een baie succesvolle opvoering van die Brickhill Bucks. Dit was ook die laatste aanbieding aan die Oh His Majesty's Theater in Commissionerstraat in Johannesburg.
Oklahoma became actually a rather important milestone in Joan and my life because it was the show that actually brought us from Durban to Johannesburg. We had for several years been running a very large theatrical academy in Durban, and we did Oklahoma as one of our very big lavish productions, which in Durban it was at that time. And strangely enough, Roy Cook of the Alexander Theatre, who is now dead, came down to see the show, and he was absolutely bowled over by what we had done. We had done several other very successful productions, The Boyfriend, Arsenic and Old Lace, quite a lot of very big productions in Durban that had been big successes. But of course, the gap between Durban and Joburg in those days was enormous. I'm now talking about 1963. And for Roy Cook to actually come down to Durban to see Oklahoma was quite something. Well, he was absolutely thrilled with the production, and he invited us to come to Johannesburg. And that was when we first decided to move up here. We closed down our academy, and we brought about 37 different children with us. When I say children, most of them were very young because they were part of the academy, and their parents gave them into our care. I'm talking about people who today are well known, even in television. Jill Osborne was one of those kids who came up with us from Durban. Trevor Wayne, and we moved lock, stock and many barrels up to Johannesburg, and we settled here, and Oklahoma was the first production that we did at the Alexander Theatre.
Today's date on the little old calendar is officially declared as MAME Day!
Hooray!
MAME Day? Isn't that wonderful, Patrick?
Wonderful. Anti-MAME?
And you know why, Mame? Because you done more for the South than anybody since Robert E. Lee.
smile. Nay. Your skin is Dixie satin. There's rebel in your manner and your speech. You may be from Manhattan, but Georgia never had a sweeter peach.
You make the old magnolia tree bud. You make camellias bloom in the mud. You make the bougainvillea turn purple at the mention of your name. Singing is starting to get out of hand. Since you brought Dixieland to Dixieland.